the Midwest floods of 2007. For smaller cities, this was that 100-year flooding event.
When we seen the house, it was snapped in two. And everything we bought, down to the littlest thing, had washed downstream.
It had rained so much, it was so deep, it had pushed the truck off the road.
I mean, the water was pounding me.
And I had to keep jumping up to get air.
I had a heart attack the year before. That wasn't a good place to have another one.
From the Weather Channel, this is Storm Stories with meteorologist Jim Cantore.
Summer in the Midwest, crops like wheat are being harvested. The livestock is out to pasture, and the open plains heat up. By August, it is typically hot, humid, and dry. And in 2007, it's even hotter than usual. Places like Louisville, Kentucky are experiencing a heat wave, a record 22 consecutive days at 90 degrees or above. By mid-August, unsettled weather starts to brew. On August 16th, Tropical Storm Erin sweeps in from the Gulf, drenching Texas. It moves up into Oklahoma, where rain continues to come down hard, dropping record amounts. At the same time, a cool front moves down from the north and stalls over the Midwest.
You had the remnant low pressure from Tropical Storm Erin still circulating, still spinning in moisture. And then you had that stationary front slowly moving its legs through the upper Midwest.
This cocktail of unusual weather players will soon collide, and the results will prove to be catastrophic for many across the Midwest.
It really was about timing and these two storms really joining up at just the right moment.
By August 18th, the warm, humid air lingering from Erin clashes with the cold front, resulting in rains not seen in parts of the Midwest in almost 100 years.
States from Wisconsin, Minnesota, Illinois, Iowa, Ohio saw 5 to 10 inches of rainfall in about an 18-hour period.
The rain will cause massive flooding across 12 states from northern Minnesota to southwest Missouri. It will force people to evacuate their homes and cause widespread damage. And because in many places the relentless rain is unexpected, dangerous flash floods will put lives at risk. It's August 20th when 69-year-old Ruth Ross leaves her home early in the morning to take her 87-year-old mother, who lives in nearby Miller, Missouri, to a doctor's appointment. Ruth doesn't think there's anything unusual about the rainstorm that greets her that day. Ruth takes pride in driving her 22-year-old Blue Ford Ranger truck. She says they've been through a lot of miles and weather together.
The closer I got to Miller, the more it was raining. And I've been over that road a lot of times, never been any water there. So I didn't think anything about pulling over or anything.
At the same time, Kenneth Mills is finishing his night shift as a short order cook at a nearby restaurant. He is also driving through Miller on Highway 39. The rain is coming down hard, pounding the country road.
Didn't realize it was gonna rain that hard that fast.
Ruth Ross and Kenneth Mills' destinies will soon collide in the wee hours of the morning on this empty road. They will be in the fight of their lives, together, yet very much alone.
The water coming across the road, and my truck stalled. So I turned on my flashers and my lights. I thought maybe somebody would come out and tow me out. Then all of a sudden, I was in it.
Water begins to fill the embankment of the country road as the rain pounds down harder. Ruth is suddenly caught in a flash flood.
I got scared because I didn't know how high the water was going to come up, and I was afraid my truck would go upside down and I might lose my sense of direction.
With no one around to help, Ruth decides to get out of her truck.
I had a heart attack the year before. I knew I had to stay calm, because that wasn't a good place to have another one. So I thought I'd walk up to that higher part of the highway where it was an upgrade, but it was too swift. So I got back in my truck.
But her truck is no longer safe. It is quickly filling up with water.
Water started coming up in my floorboard. I got out and I held on to the front bumper.
Ruth worries that she will drown in the rapidly moving waters. She looks up and sees something in the distance.
A little white truck came, and I didn't know who it was at the time.
I pulled up and I saw her truck, and I hollered out her, hang on, you know, I was gonna try to drive down through there on the high side of the road and get to her and throw a rope to her.
While Ruth clenches her bumper, Kenneth prepares his rescue.
She just was screaming for help, you know, and there wasn't nobody else around.
I'm just thinking, thank God somebody's coming to rescue me.
The water rises even higher, gains momentum, and is increasingly swift and violent. Kenneth's good deed is about to go awry.
He didn't even quite get to me, and he just went right over the bank. The flood water just pushed him right over.
I got about halfway, then the field just rose up like the ocean. My truck started sliding, and I knew I was gone.
He went right over, across the highway, down this bank, and out into this pasture before he even got to where I was.
The power of the current is strong, and Ruth loses strength to hold onto the bumper.
The flood water swept me over, across the highway, and down the bank.
Kenneth is not only unable to help Ruth, but now he's at risk of drowning himself.
I went off in a ditch, in the deep part. My truck's just floating around. I'm sitting in the driver's seat. I started seeing water coming in the truck through the heater vents. And I knew I was gone, you know, because water just gushing through there and just kept going up and up and up. Finally, I got scared. I didn't know what to do, so I climbed out of the truck.
Kenneth finds temporary safety on his truck's rooftop while Ruth floats downstream, fearing the whipping waters will take her under. Then, out of nowhere, she spots a log.
I was lucky, it just came straight in front of my bumper. And then it has the little branches sticking up, and I had a hold of one just like a saddle horn on a saddle.
Violent waters are taking everything down, and the force of the water ripped Kenneth's clothes right off his back.
Took my shoes off, my shirt.
His shirt had got sucked off as he went over the bank.
To make matters even worse, Kenneth doesn't know how to swim and is now in the fight for his life.
All I could see was his head, because he was on the cab of his truck holding onto the windshield wiper.
The two of them are stuck in different areas only 30 feet apart. They can see each other, but are unable to help each other. Ruth sees Kenneth losing his ability to hang on.
The only time that I did talk to Kenneth was when he was threatening to jump out of his truck, because I didn't know where he would go.
Kenneth continues to fight the currents while Ruth is still stationary. She's somehow been able to balance on the log.
Kenneth was closer to where the water was coming right off of the bank, so he was actually getting more water than me.
The roadway is desolate. Ruth and Kenneth wonder if they will survive, if anyone will find them. 1 hour passes with them fighting the water, and then a lucky break. Volunteer Fire Chief David Rose stumbles upon the scene driving home from a work call. What he sees is chilling.
He was standing in the back of the truck, leaning forward over the back glass, and he was holding on to windshield wipers and then holding on to the top of the cab. I immediately got on the radio and started, frankly, hollering at Lawrence County, telling him, send me help, send me all the help you got.
Once he realizes that he can't reach Kenneth, he turns his attention to Ruth. He quickly learns that he is not equipped to help either one of them.
I could not go in to get her because, you know, it was a dangerous situation and I couldn't do it by myself. So that's why I called in all the help I could get.
Remnants of Tropical Storm Erin bring unexpected amounts of rain, which is causing flooding across the Midwest. On Highway 39 in Missouri, two people are caught in the fight of their lives due to a flash flood. Fire Chief David Rose stumbles onto the scene and radios back for help.
I hollered at him and told him, hang on, stay where you're at. I've got help on the way. And I could hear him yelling, help, help.
They couldn't reach me. You know, they kept hollering at me. hang on. And then the water kept hitting me in the face, and I just wore out from breathing and going up and down, you know.
I seen the guy's head go underwater 3 different times, and I knew he was gone.
I tried to stand up to get my head up out of the water. When I did, the pressure of the water just knocked me down. And then I opened my eyes underwater, and I go up and get air and go back under and go back up. Did that for like an hour and a half.
The water was ramping off of his windshield and going up and over the cab of the truck. And he was reaching up over the cab trying to hang on.
There were a couple times I also wondered if I was going to make it there because there was so much water over the road, and it was just a dangerous situation even getting to that scene.
Within 15 minutes, Miller County Sheriff Brad DeLay arrives at the scene.
While on my way out there, I had got another call from dispatch that now in that same location, there were now 2 separate motorists that had been washed off the roadway and were stranded and possibly going to be swept down this little creek, which was now a river, into the larger Spring River.
The situation is even worse than he expects.
Ms. Ross is holding onto this branch pretty good, and not more than another 25, 30 yards from her was Mr. Mills on top of his truck with the water rushing around him everywhere. And I mean, you could tell he was very nervous and scared.
I mean, the water was pounding him and then going over his head.
And the water hit me where I stuck my head up and boom, I went down and hit the back of the tailgate. And I thought I was gone. I thought I was gonna wash away then.
There was, at times, water going over the top of the truck at 3 feet.
Mr. Mills looked like he was going to jump off of his truck into the water and try to essentially make his way back to the roadway.
He was screaming frantically, and I looked at the guy, and he looked like he was going to jump into the water, and we're screaming, "Do not jump. Do not jump."
He could have made the situation a lot worse had he let go, because the waters were very swift, and he was really a smaller man to start with, so I don't think he would have had a very good chance of sustaining those currents and making it back to the roadway.
Fire Chief David Rose's radio for help has also alerted other local authorities, as well as the media. A group gathers on the side of the road and watches in disbelief, but no one can do anything.
It was a little scary, again, because we just didn't know what was going on. We didn't know what was going to happen because we hadn't really done anything like that before.
Probably what struck me the most is that you're in all this water and there's people on either side of you and they can't do anything to help you.
Finally, after 2 hours, the rains are letting up, giving rescuers an opportunity to reach the couple.
Hooray, hooray, I was thinking when I'd seen those 2 guys. And they had on life jackets, and they brought one out to me.
With flood gear in hand, Sheriff DeLay goes into the water to physically grab hold of Ruth and Kenna. They pull out Ruth first, since she is further out in the water and at greater risk.
We reached Miss Ross first. We put a life vest on her and gave her some rope, and we brought her on shore.
And when I stood up, I said, "Guys, my legs is real tired." I said, "I gotta crawl." So I just crawled a little ways, and then the guys up on the bank got a hold of me and pulled me on up.
Now it was time to rescue Kenneth.
They waited out there because the water kept going down then. I couldn't swim, so I wasn't gonna let go, and they had to pull me off my truck.
We suited him up in the life vest and tied him down and then brought him back to the shore, just basically the exact same way we did with Miss Ross.
It was like climbing up a ledge that was 4 or 5 feet, you know, and there was no way that he could climb up that. And I reached in and locked my hand around his wrist and just raised him up to get him out of there. And he was like a rag doll. He had no strength left.
You could tell it definitely affected him pretty good and understandably when the only thing that's basically saving your life is holding onto your windshield wipers and being swept away into the river. He had a pretty near-death experience.
Later that day, Ruth learns that this strand of barbed wire hooked into her log, keeping her stationary in the whipping waters. The barbed wire prevented her from traveling downstream and potentially being in even greater danger.
Barbed wire had broke on the fence at the bottom of the bank, and it had caught on that big limb. And the big limb could go out so far before it was the end of that piece of barbed wire that it caught on. That's why I didn't go on.
Ruth is amazed by her good fortune that day.
I consider myself lucky four times that day. First of all, the big limb came by and I got on it. Second of all, my truck didn't come on top of me. Thirdly, a long strand of that barbed wire had caught onto that big limb I was on. And then fourth, the two guys came out and rescued me.
Kenneth is just happy to be alive.
It's scary. Scariest thing I've ever been in.
I don't know how he held on that long, but he did it. And everything worked out. He's a very lucky person. Very lucky. They both are.
By the time the rain subsided that morning, an astounding 11.94 inches of rain has fallen in Miller in just under 9 hours.
That is just unheard of, not only for the fact that this was a tropical system that was affecting the Midwest, but the fact that this much rainfall fell in such a short amount of time.
Ruth and Kenneth's near-death experience will turn out to be just one of many dramatic stories unfolding as a result of the rain. All over the area, there is massive flooding. Rivers are overflowing, homes are saturated, and residents' lives are being changed forever. Angela and Shannon Steinmetz live just 3 miles down the road from where the flash flood occurred.
The roads were washed out, and we hiked in and seen our house, and it was completely destroyed. They picked it up and just wrapped it around a tree and snapped it in half.
It's a good thing we weren't there. We would have died in it.
August 21st, the flash flooding caused by unexpected amounts of rainfall across Missouri finally settles. But across the Midwest, there is massive flooding.
During the Midwest floods of 2007, for a lot of smaller cities, this was that 100-year flooding event where they had water at all-time levels.
States like Minnesota and Wisconsin received up to 15 inches of rainfall. In Ohio, the Blanchard River rises 7.5 feet over flood stage, 18.5 foot high, just shy of the record at Findlay.
We have such an interconnected system of rivers that run throughout all of this area, and you get 10 inches of rainfall in one particular location, that water has to flow somewhere.
One of the places that the water flows is inland to the home of Angela and Shannon Steinmetz. They are returning from a short vacation when they hear their neighborhood is hit the hardest by the floods.
As we drove down, we seen the destruction from all the neighbors. Corrals, fences, cattle, everything was gone.
As they drive closer to their house, they suddenly see water all around. Roads are now ponds. Open fields are swamps. The reality of the situation begins to sink in. They have no idea what to expect.
We were winding around the road, then it just wouldn't go no further.
The road is overflowing with water. They park and walk 3 miles to reach their home.
As we look, the house was snapped in half.
In shock and horror, Angela and Shannon begin to look closer at what was once their home. All of their dreams, like thousands of people across the Midwest, unravel before their very eyes. The strength and velocity of the storm has literally ripped right through their house. The house is split in half, leaving nothing but a trail of debris behind. There is not even one item that could be saved.
The water had came in the house and like flushed through, so it took like the kitchen table, our desk, everything.
It plucked the refrigerator out of the kitchen and then buried it in the neighbor's field.
Yeah, we lost everything right down to a garden hose.
Angela and Shannon stay with friends as they rebuild their lives and are grateful that the day the storm visited, they were away, but they missed the place they once called home.
It was a really nice place.
Blooming crab apple tree.
Yeah.
It's gorgeous. Lots of shade. And it's really pretty.
The Steinmetz are hardly alone in their grief. The flood damage is extensive across 12 states. In Ohio, thousands of people are evacuated, and the town of Findlay, just under 3 hours from Cincinnati, remains underwater for a day. About 10,000 homes are flooded and several hundred destroyed. 22 deaths across the central United States are attributed to the floods as the water lingers for weeks. The August 2007 Midwest floods proved to be the worst flooding in this part of the Midwest in almost a century. The cost of the damage was in the millions of dollars. After Ruth's life-threatening ordeal ends, she calls firefighter David Rose with one more request.
She's like, I want that truck fixed, and that's what she's driving today.
Even though Kenneth put himself in a near-death situation to save a stranger, he says he would do it all over again.
Someone's hollering for help. Can't stand here and watch them drown.
For the Steinmetz, they are grateful that they still have each other. Friends rally around them.
They said, we got a vacation cabin. You're more than welcome to come stay there.
Neighbor reaching out to neighbor, proving that even in the worst of circumstances, the best side of humanity can emerge. For the Weather Channel, I'm meteorologist Jim Cantore. Your local forecast is next.